I think of a lot of the great producers, of which you are one. And I think about guys like George Martin, Quincy Jones, that come from arranger musician realm. I think of like Rick Rubin, who famously does not play an instrument, does not touch a knob, is much more of a philosophical, almost like guru coach and an outside ear. Where do you feel like you fit into that? What is your skill as a producer, if you can pinpoint it? Or where do you what's your essential approach to things? Where do you come from?
I like to think that I've learned from all of those people. I mean, both George Martin and George was and Rick is a friend. And what's interesting is, of course, though, a sort of side note to that is most of us have not watched each other work. We don't really know what each other do. Most producers judge each other by the results. You know, we all know that we have some records we love that George Martin did or Rick Rubin did. Exactly what they did, only the artist probably knows, you know. And the best approval rating of a producer can get is when the artist decides, I enjoyed that, let's do it again, you know, let's make the next record together because it worked. I think I'm somewhere in the middle of all of that. I think of myself very much as an arranger, you know, and I don't mean obviously not someone like Quincy, who's a musical genius, you know, but who can tell every single instrument what to play and write it all out and everything. But in terms of coming up with a concept of how we should do the song, you know, what kind of instrumentation, what kind of tempo, what kind of groove, you know, and trying stuff out in the studio until it gets to be right. I think we all know too that record production has a psychological aspect. I mean, it's sometimes the mood of the session can count for a lot. You know, it because things can get weird, things can get fun, you know, and I think it's the producer has a lot to do with all of that. I've also always thought that one of the producer's functions is knowing when to stop, and I mean that in each case in so many different ways. I mean, for example, if you are doing stuff with a live band, you know, it's knowing when you've got the right take and you know when you don't need to do it again. Famously, George Martin, there's a story, and I'm trying to remember the exact words that we used, but Bird Bacharach had flown over to London to oversee the production of the Cilla Black version of, I guess it would have been Alfie, one of those Bacharach songs that she did. And Bacharach was incredibly demanding in the studio. He would have her sing it again, and they cut this again, and they do this. And at one point, apparently, George, who was kind of Cilla's normal producer and kind of co-producing this thing, I guess, said to him, you know, Bert, what is it exactly that you're looking for? You know, and he said, I'm just looking for something with a little more emotion and a little more whatever, you know, whatever he said. And George said, I think you'll find that on take three. And I went, there you go. You know, that's one of the functions. You know, in the same way, I think the producer, when I say knows when to stop, it's if you're working on a song and it just isn't, it's not, you know, it's not falling into place and you've been at it for hours. Sometimes you have to go, maybe we don't like the song, you know, maybe it's the wrong song, maybe the song's not finished, you know. Let's stop. Let's move on to something else. And that can be important too. Otherwise, if you do another 4 or 5 hours on it, everyone gets in a really bad mood and the whole day is screwed up. So the producer has a lot of different things, but I think knowing when to stop is one of them.
Yeah, I realized that with a couple of records I was working on in Malibu before I left, maybe a few weeks ago, where I worked on back to back sessions, and one of them, the artist was basically looking to me to tell them to do more. Like they would have just done a take if I said that was great. And then the next day, so I had to push, let's do more, let's find more, let's explore. This is the safe place. Let's see what we can come up with. It was a bit like the project we worked on together. And then the next day I had someone who was like, I need to do more. I need to do more. It's not enough takes. And I was like, I think we got it. It was like we got it on take three, but they just keep going and going. And you know, it seems like sometimes that's necessary. The artist needs to, even if you have it on take two, the artist needs to kind of get it all out to feel committed to the process.
Exactly. And sometimes there's terrific singers who don't think they've got it when you know, Don Henley has been known to do like a zillion takes, and he's a fantastic singer. You know, and again, back to take three, have a listen. Oh, Jesus, I did this already.
I just listened to, I don't know if you and I watched, but Don Henley did a version of Boys of Summer on Howard Stern in the last few years, and he's telling a story about the original version of it. Oh no, it was he did Boys of Summer, and he also did Desperado, and he said he hated the Desperado vocal because he only got to do four takes of it or spend a few hours in the studio. And for me, that's like, you know, my father played that growing up, like that's an iconic vocal and it's so great, and he's a guy who's like, I never liked that vocal. Just
no, it's true. No, and of course, you know, Linda had it eventually, actually had it with it, and he always says, Don says he likes Linda's version better, but Don's an incredible singer.